Thank you, Brother David, and it's good to see you tonight as we have come together for our midweek Bible study. And I invite you to open your Bibles once again to the book of Joshua, where we have been for quite some time now. We are about to conclude our study through this book, The Life and the Legacy of Joshua. But tonight, we're going to be looking primarily at chapter number 23, and then there are some other verses that I want to tie together with this and link together with this, but primarily we'll be in the 23rd chapter tonight of the book of Joshua. And of course, this is his final farewell, these last two chapters, and I think that we find some very interesting things in these last two chapters. You know, I could say that throughout history that we have been blessed by having the accounts of some very moving stories that we really could say were stories of great people as they were passing the torch on to others, and how when we read those words that they said in those moments, how moving they are. For example, I think about Washington's farewell to the Continental Army, or I think about Douglas MacArthur's farewell address to Congress when he said, an old soldier who tried to do his duty as God gave him the light to see his duty, goodbye. And that was his final farewell. But when we open the Bible, we also see a lot of recorded moving farewells as men of God were passing on the torch to others. And that's what we find when we get to Joshua 23 and 24. When I think about some of the moving biblical charges that were passed on to others, there are a couple that come to my mind. Number one was Joseph over in the book of Genesis chapter 50, verses 24 and 25, when Joseph was reaching the end of his life. It says, and Joseph said to his brethren, I am dying, but God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land to the land of which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, and that's the land we've been studying about over these past several months. Verse 25, then Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here. So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. Very moving and stirring and inspiring words. Some of my favorite, though, were words that were spoken by the Apostle Paul, and when he was giving his farewell address to the Ephesian elders, remember he was on his way for his last trip to Jerusalem, and there was a stopover, and he was on the island of Miletus, and he said to them in Acts chapter 20, verse 25, and indeed, now I know that you all among you that I've given, that I've gone preaching the kingdom of God, but you'll see my face no more. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I'm innocent of the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God. Therefore, take heed to yourselves and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Also from among yourselves, men will rise up, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after themselves. Therefore, watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease to warn every one of you day and night with tears. That was his farewell address to the Ephesian elders. But then we come to the final two chapters in the book of Joshua, and that's what we have here. We have Joshua's final farewell address, and we know that was the case because if you look in chapter 23, verse number 14, Joshua says, behold, this day I am going the way of all the earth. And what is the way of all the earth? It is death. Kind of reminds us of what the writer of Hebrews says when he said that it's appointed unto man once to die, and then after this, the judgment. And so in these final two chapters, he addresses the people of God that he's led to possess the promised land. Chapter 23 primarily is an address to the leaders. We get to chapter 24, and he assembles the entire congregation at Shechem, and there he addresses all of the people. But it's his final address. And when I think about Joshua's final address, like Joseph's, like the Apostle Paul, I think that they could do so and they had absolutely no regrets of the way that they had lived. You know, that's the way I want to go out, don't you? Ending life with no regrets. Eric Fromm, the famous psychologist, in his book, Man for Himself, said, and I quote, "To die is poignantly bitter, but the idea of having to die without having lived is unbearable." What a horrible way to die. Joshua didn't end his earthly life like that. From the time that he was born in Egypt as a slave to the time that he ended his life in a worship service in the Promised Land in chapter number 24, he lived his life for the glory of God, and he lived it to the absolute fullest. In between, God had used him in a remarkable way. God had used him to lead the children of Israel. God had used him to defeat the enemies as they were on their way to the land of Canaan. God had used him when he got into the land of Canaan to conquer it and then give out the allotments of the land. I think that Joshua was a lot like the Apostle Paul, and he could say, like Paul said at his death in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse number 7, "I fought a good fight. I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. And henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, and not for me alone, but for all of those who love his appearing." I think that's the way that this great man of God, General Joshua, who led the conquest of the land, I think that that is the way that he ended his life. But when we come to chapter 23, we, as far as I'm concerned, we see something very interesting about Joshua. And it may have been the thing that made him such a mighty man of God. And that is, what was his concern when he ended his life? Joshua 23 tells us that his greatest concern was not for himself, but his greatest concern was for the people God had called him to lead, that they would continue to follow the Lord, and that they would be the people of God that God had called them to be, and they would experience all that God had for them to experience. So that was his greatest concern. And I think that we see that being brought out with two major ideas that I see in this chapter. And once again, we're just going to put the outline point, and we'll give you the verses. Instead of reading all these verses at one time, we're going to read the verses as we go. But the first thing that we see in verses 1 through 8 of chapter 23 is his challenge to the leaders. Now, obviously, the challenge to the leaders in chapter 23 came before the challenge to the people in chapter 24. Because, you see, if the people don't have leaders to follow, leaders who are following God, then they're going to be in trouble themselves. And so, first of all, the challenge is to the leaders. And I wish sometimes that we as church leaders, I'm talking about staff, deacons, trustees, Sunday school teachers, all of us in leadership position, if we could understand just the weight of the responsibility that God places upon us in leading others. Number one, what a great privilege, but number two, what an awesome responsibility that is. And so in verses 1 through 8, we see the challenge to the leaders. Verse number 1 says, "Now it came to pass, a long time after the Lord had given rest to Israel from all their enemies round about, that Joshua was old, and he was advanced and aged. And so Joshua called for Israel, for the elders, for their heads, for their judges, for their officers, and he said to them," the leaders, "I am old and advanced in age. You have seen all that the Lord your God has done, all of these nations, because of you, for the Lord your God is he who has fought for you. See, I have divided to you by lot these nations that remain to be an inheritance for your tribes, from the Jordan with all of the nations that I have cut off as far as the great sea westward. And the Lord your God will expel them from before you and drive them out of your sight. So you shall possess the land as the Lord your God promised you. Therefore be courageous to keep and to do all that is written in the book of the law of Moses, lest you turn aside from it to the right hand or to the left, and lest you go among these nations, these who remain among you. You shall not make mention of the name of their gods, nor cause anyone to swear by them. You shall not serve them, nor bow down to them. But you shall hold fast to the Lord your God, as you have done to this day. So he's challenging them as leaders. I think verse number 3, we see something that stuck out to me as saying, wow, how extremely important this idea is. In verse number 3, when he says, you have seen all that the Lord your God has done to all of the nations because of you. Now mark this, for the Lord your God is he who has fought for you. It was almost like he was telling the leaders, now you always remember and you remind the people who it is that's given you the victory. It was not because of your great military prowess. It was not because of your great ability. It was because of the Lord God. So always give God the credit. And don't take the credit for yourself, nor the glory for yourself, but give that unto the Lord. And so when I think about this challenge that was given, they had crossed over the Jordan River. Through God's strength, they had conquered and possessed the promised land. God had given them rest. And I think that at this point that we see something in this challenge that is absolutely vital to us understanding that is a part of all human nature. Where were they at their life at this particular point? Prosperity and rest. Prosperity and plenty. Life was good. Provisions were abundant. They had no lack of anything. And all of a sudden, the Lord challenges the leaders. Now here is my main concern for you, that you might drift away from God. In this time in your life, there is that temptation, that you might drift away from God. Now friend, that tells us something important about all of human nature, and that is that prosperity is a much greater temptation than adversity in falling away from the Lord. You know, during times of adversity, what do we tend to do? We tend to get close to God, draw near to God, trust God, depend upon God, rely upon God. Adversity seems to having a way of driving us to the Lord. But during times of prosperity, it's not always the case, is it? During times of prosperity, we tend to become self-confident and self-reliant. You know, man, if the our bank account's full, we don't have anything to worry about. Health is good. Everything's going great in our family. You know, those are the times that if we're not careful, that prosperity will draw us away from the Lord. And so it's interesting what Joshua does here to try to challenge these leaders to stay close to the Lord. Verses 1 through 5, I would say that the first thing that he did was he said to them, remember God's goodness. Remember God's goodness. That's exactly what those verses were about. You know, there was one thing that the nation of Israel could never deny, and that was God's goodness had been expressed to them in such incredible ways. I mean, when they looked throughout their history, they could not deny the goodness of God that had sat down upon them. I mean, from the day that they left Egypt, the mighty hand of God covered up the Egyptian army that was following after them in the Red Sea, to the time soon after they came out of Egypt and the Amalekites, a mighty army, attacked them, and God defended them and God defeated the Amalekites. Through the time that they were going toward the promised land, and God helped them defeat every enemy, and the time they got into the promised land, and God helped them to conquer the land, and then he'd given them the allotment of the land, God had been so very good to them. And that is what he's reminding them of here in these first five verses. And you know, we might ask the question, well, what was the purpose of this historical review for the Israelites? I believe the historical review was given so that it would boost their confidence that as God had done in the past, God would continue to do in the present and also in the future. There's nothing that will help us in tackling issues in the present and the future like looking back and seeing the faithfulness and the goodness of God in the past. And so years have gone by, and we know according to verse number one, since the major part of the conquest, because it said it came to pass that a long time after the Lord had given rest to Israel, that now Joshua begins to address them. And what he's trying to remind them of is, look, you're in the land, you've been given the allotment, but I want you to understand that your struggle is not yet over. That even though you're in the land, you're possessing it, understand there's still going to be resistance along the way. And because there will be resistance along the way, because there will be a struggle in the land to maintain your victory, it's going to require a day-by-day faithfulness on your part to the Lord to maintain that victory. And you know, really we could say that this is the perfect picture of the Christian life. Because I know all of us wish that when we came to know Christ as our Lord and Savior and we were born again, all of us wish that at that point, all of our problems and all of our struggles and all of our trials and all of those issues were over at the moment of our conversion. But that's just not the way the Christian life works. And so the counsel then that Joshua gave to them is the same counsel that will work for you and I as well. If we're going to maintain the victory God gave us at the moment of our conversion, now I'm not saying maintain our salvation and keeping it by our own effort, but if we're going to maintain that victory and live the life of victory, it's going to require faithfulness, obedience, and self-discipline on our part. And that's the very crux of the challenge that Joshua was issuing to these leaders. So he said, first of all, that you are to remember God's goodness. But then in verses 6 through 8, he said, I want you to reflect upon your responsibility. Verse number 6, therefore, be very courageous to keep and to do all that is written in the book of the law of Moses, lest you turn aside from it to the right hand or to the left. Be careful, be courageous. Lest you go among these nations, those who remain among you, you shall not make mention of the name of their gods, nor cause anyone to swear by them. You shall not serve them, nor bow down to them, but you shall hold fast to the Lord your God, as you have done up to this day. This is what you've done in the past, and this is what you must continue to do. Now, there are three things here that I want to bring out of this text that as far as Joshua was concerned under the leadership of the Lord, that these people were responsible to do. And the final two things really flowed from the first thing, the major thing, the most important thing, which was obedience. Obedience. Now, when we read through the book of Joshua, we seem like this was one of Joshua's favorite words. And I often wondered why that was, but, you know, obedience would be a natural emphasis for a soldier such as Joshua to make. I mean, anybody who has ever served in the military will tell you that nothing works without obedience to one's superior officer. And if there's disobedience to that superior officer, then there's going to be trouble throughout the ranks. And who was Joshua's superior officer? It was God. And so he's stressing the importance of obedience to the Lord. Joshua's success and also the reason for all of Israel's past victories, what was it? It was devotion to the Word of God. Verse 6, I'll read it again. Therefore, be very courageous to keep and to do all that is written in the law of Moses. Verse number 14, behold, this day I am going the way of all the earth, and you know in all of your hearts and in all of your souls that not one thing has failed of all of the good things which the Lord your God spoke concerning you. But all have come to pass for you, and not one word has failed. And therefore, I'm challenging you and I'm encouraging you to keep God's word. Obey God's word. You know, I was thinking about that, and I began to look at all of the places in Joshua where we can string those thoughts together and look at the emphasis that Joshua placed on obeying God's word. And I want you to turn back to chapter 1 with me. I want to read verse, and I want to, if you can, just kind of follow along with me. And I hope this helps you, because it really helped me and gave me a new appreciation for what Joshua was saying here by putting them all together and just reading them right out of God's word to see the emphasis that he was placing on the importance of obedience. Chapter 1, verse 7, only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. The book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Then Joshua commanded the officers of the people, saying, obey the word of God. Look down at verse number 13. Remember the word which Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, saying, the Lord your God is giving you rest and is giving you this land. Your wives, your little ones, and your livestock shall remain in the land which Moses gave you on that side of the Jordan. But you shall pass before your brethren armed, all your mighty men of valor, and help them, until the Lord has given your brethren rest, as he gave you, and they also have taken possession of the land which the Lord your God is giving them. And then you shall return to the land of your possession and enjoy it, which Moses, the Lord's servant, gave you on this side of the Jordan toward the sunrise. So they answered Joshua, saying, all that you command us, we will do, and wherever you send us, we will go. And just as he heeded Moses in all things, so we will heed you. Only the Lord your God be with you as he was with Moses. Whoever rebels against your command and does not heed your words and all that you commanded him shall be put to death. Only be strong and of good courage and obey the word of God. Over in chapter 8, verse number 30. And I won't take the rest of the night reading these, but what better could we do than read the Bible? Amen. Chapter 8, verse number 30. Now Joshua built an altar to the Lord God of Israel in Mount Ebal, as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded the children of Israel, as it is written in the book of the law of Moses, an altar of whole stones over which no man has wielded an iron tool. That's what Moses commanded, so that's what they did. And they offered on it burnt offerings to the Lord and sacrificed peace offerings. And there in the presence of the children of Israel, he wrote on the stones a copy of the law of Moses, which he had written. And then all of Israel with their elders and officers and judges, they stood on either side of the ark before the priests, the Levites, who bore the ark of the covenant of the Lord, the stranger, as well as he was who was born among them. Half of them were in front of Mount Gerizim, the other half in front of Mount Ebal, as Moses, servant of the Lord, had commanded before they should bless the people of Israel. And afterward, he, Joshua, read all of the words of the law, the blessings and the cursings, according to all that is written in the book of the law. There was not a word of all that Moses had commanded, which Joshua did not read before all of the assembly of Israel, the women, the little ones, the strangers who were living among them. In other words, obedience to God's word was absolutely essential for the people of God then. By the way, it's still essential for us today. Chapter 11, verse number 12. So all the cities of those kings and all of the kings Joshua took, and he struck with the edge of the sword. He utterly destroyed them, as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded. Verse 15, as the Lord had commanded Moses, his servant, so Moses commanded Joshua, and Joshua did. He left nothing undone of all that the Lord had commanded Moses. I mean, it's amazing to put all that together and see how much of a theme that was in the entire book. The idea of obedience. Joshua believed God's promises. He obeyed God's commands, and God worked in his behalf. Want to know the key to their success? Friend, there it was right there. Makes me stop and say, success cannot be divorced from obedience. Those two ideas always go together. And you know, God defines success a lot different than the world does. Amen. You know, God doesn't say success is building a great material empire. Now, if someone builds a great material empire and serves God and loves him and obeys him, that's fine. Not against that, but that's not the measure of success. The measure of success, dear friends, is living in obedience to what God has commanded. And down in verse number 14, Joshua pointed out that God had kept all of his promises, a bit of his word. Verse 14, behold, this day I'm going the way of all the earth, and you know in all of your hearts and in all of your souls that not one thing has failed of all the good things which the Lord your God spoke concerning you. All of them have come to pass for you. Not one word of them has failed. It's almost like Joshua saying, I want y'all to think about that. Everything God said to you, he did. Every promise God gave you, he kept. And now God has every right to expect you to keep his commandments as well. God gave you promises, he kept them. He gave you commandments, and he has every right to expect that you keep them. You know, when we think about the promises of God, we would say that, you know, some of God's promises are unconditional, but there are many of those promises that are conditional, that are conditioned, that are dependent upon our obedience for their fulfillment. And it's not like just jump to the Bible, claim a promise. A lot of those promises are conditioned upon our obedience. Israel had entered the land, they'd conquered the land as what? A fulfillment of God's promise. But it seems to me Joshua was saying that their enjoyment of the land depended on their obedience to the law of the Lord. It was kind of like John 10:10. What an amazing promise. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. But the enjoyment of that abundant life is dependent upon our obedience to walk in the way the Lord tells us to walk. So God would enable them to claim all of their inheritance if they would obey him with all of their hearts. There's something very interesting that I picked up on here that's in the text that we see when we kind of read between the lines. And that's the connection between obedience and God's good actions in the past on behalf of his people. How did he begin this chapter? Remember God's goodness. Remember how good God has been to you in the past. And then he jumps ahead and he talks to them about obedience. It seems to me that what the Bible's pointing out here is that's the strongest motivation there is for obeying God, to remember how good God has been to us. You know, that's the way that the Ten Commandments began. I don't know if you ever thought about it like that, but Exodus chapter 20, verse 1, and God spoke all of these words saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. I've been good to you. Then he begins, because of that, you shall have no other gods before me. Why should you have no other gods before me? Because I, the one true and living God, have been so good to you. I've delivered you from bondage. I've delivered you from slavery. I have in my grace taken you out of Egypt. And therefore, he says, what are you to do? Have no other gods before me. Friend, that's a strong motivation for obeying the Lord. So there seems to be this inextricable connection between God having given them the land by his goodness and by his grace and the obedience that now God was requiring. It wasn't that just God just jumped up and said, hey, I'm God, you're not, obey me. It's like he was giving them the reasons for it. You know, when we read the Bible, it's not unusual to read a passage of Scripture where we will see the Scripture offering up certain considerations that will bolster our resolve to exercise our will to obedience. For example, we find in Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, verse number 34. Mark chapter 8 and verse number 34. When he called the people to himself, he said to his disciples also, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. And that was a command. And then he goes down further and he says, now this is why you ought to do it. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will it man give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father and with his holy angels. If you'll come after me, deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. Why? Question mark. He tells them, because whoever desires to save his life is going to lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's is going to save it. And we see that running consistently throughout the Scripture, that pattern or that principle. Remember in 2 Samuel, I don't have time because time's getting away, but remember in 2 Samuel chapter 12 when Nathan the prophet came to King David after David's affair and then committing murder by killing Uriah. And Nathan the prophet, God was speaking through him, encouraging David to repent of what he had done. And what was it that motivated David to repent, to obey God and repent? Nathan told him a story, remember, about a rich man and a poor man, and how the rich man took the lamb of the poor man, and David ended up saying, you know, man, that's the most wicked thing I've ever heard about. You know, take his life, kill him, and, you know, let him pay fourfold for what he has done, and just on and on and on. And then Nathan said, you're the man. And then he went on through this long litany of things. David, you need to do this because you need to consider how good God was to you, how God called you out of being a shepherd boy and placed you on the throne. And God blessed you with a family. And God blessed you with a kingdom. And because of God's goodness on your life, you need to repent of this evil that you have done. It seems to be a consistent theme that runs throughout Scripture, that our motive for obedience is based on one thing, is remembering the goodness of God. And so down back in Joshua in verses 9 and 10, he seeks to move Israel to obedience by recalling to them the grace of God. But now, moving on in verses 11 through 13, read these verses and then I'll make this comment. Therefore, take careful heed to yourselves that you love the Lord your God. Or else, if indeed you do go back and you cling to the remnant of these nations, these that remain among you, and you make marriages with them, and you go into them, and they to you know for certain that the Lord your God will no longer drive out these nations from before you, but they shall be snares and traps to you, and scourges on your sides, and thorns in your eyes, and until you perish from this good land which the Lord your God has given to you. So back in verses 9 and 10, he's appealing to the grace of God to motivate them to obedience. Here he's appealing to the fear of God to motivate their obedience. So Joshua argues, first of all, from the memory of God's goodness, but then secondly, from the threat of God's judgment. Don't you see how he lines those two things up and uses them as appeals and motives? So the grace of God and the fear of God should move God's people to obey God. Did you get that? The grace of God and the fear of God should motivate God's people to obedience. There are those who tell us that New Testament Christians are no longer subject to the fear of God. Friend, I want to tell you a cure for that kind of thinking. Spend an afternoon in the Epistle to the Hebrews. Boy, that'll change that kind of thinking. Because Hebrews 10:31 says to New Testament Christians, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. So the grace of God and the fear of God, both of those ought to be in the lives of believers, and both of those are strong motivators for us obeying God. So number one, he steps up to these leaders and he said, I want you to do this. I want you to teach your people to do this, to obey God. Then down in verse number 11, the second thing he says is to love God. Therefore, take careful heed to yourselves that you love the Lord your God. Now, over and over and over again in this book, he brings up the law of Moses, memorizing it, meditating on it, learning it. Obviously, to obey God's law, they would have to read it. The more they read it, the more they would know God. The more they knew God, the more they would love God, because he would become personal to them. But you know, I asked myself the question, what did Joshua mean when he said, take careful heed to yourselves that you love the Lord your God? What is that? How do we define that? How do we describe that? I think the best description of that is in the previous chapter, chapter 22 and verse number 5, when Joshua said, but take careful heed to do the commandment and the law which Moses, a servant of the Lord, commanded you, to love the Lord your God. Here it is: to walk in all of his ways, to keep his commandments, to hold fast to him, and to serve him with all of your heart and with all of your soul. That verse is tied to the verse that all Israelites would have known, their Shema, back in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, which says to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, with all of your strength. What does it mean to love God? According to Joshua 22:5, it means to walk in his ways, obey his commandments, hold fast, cling to him. He's the priority. To serve him with all of our hearts and all of our souls. See, obeying God cannot be separated from loving God. The two go together. And, you know, the very height of hypocrisy would be to say, I love God, but then not obey what is written in the Bible. The very pinnacle of the Christian life, as far as an expression of loving the Lord, is obeying what we find in the written scriptures. So obedience and love, they are always linked together. And then he said the third thing to these leaders I want you to do and teach your people to do, and that's to live a life of separation. Verse number 12, or else if you do go back and you cling to the remnant of these nations, these that remain among you, and you make marriages with them, and you go into them, and they to you, then he tells down in verse number 13 what is going to happen to them. And so Joshua knew the danger of mixing their marriages. Because if they mixed their marriages, then the darkness of the pagans would put out the light of the Jews. And pretty soon they would sacrifice their religious faith on the altar of their paganism and idolatry. So he said, you've got to live a life that is separated from them. Now, evidently, they did not listen to what Joshua said. Because in Judges chapter 2, listen to these verses, verses 7 through 10. So the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all of the great works of the Lord which he had done for Israel. Now Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, he died when he was 110 years old, and they buried him within the border of his inheritance at Timnath Heres in the mountains of Ephraim on the north side of Mount Gaash. And when all of the generation had been gathered to their fathers, that's the leaders that Joshua was instructing. So when that generation had been gathered to their fathers, another generation arose after them who did not know the Lord nor the work which he had done for Israel. So evidently, they did not instruct the people. And evidently, the people did not instruct their children. You know, this is a good place for me to emphasize how essential it is for one generation to pass down scriptural teaching to the next generation. It is absolutely vital. Psalm 78, verse 2. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children, telling to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and his wonderful works that he has done. That's what we're going to talk to the next generation about. For he established a testimony in Jacob, and he appointed a law in Israel that he commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children, that that generation to come might know them, the children who would be born, that they might arise and declare them to their children, so that they may set their hope in God and not forget the works of God. That's what happens when one generation passes down scriptural, biblical teaching to the next generation. And by the way, did you know that it's really not particularly the job of the church to do that? Now, as a church, we'd want to do that. I'm telling you, every ministry of First Baptist Church, the children's ministry, the youth ministry, the preschool ministry, every ministry is focused on the Word of God, teaching it, instructing, discipling. That's what we are about as a church. But it is not particularly the job of the First Baptist Church to do that for children. It is particularly the job of Christian parents. Christian parents have that responsibility. We've got to be witnesses in our homes, because this may very well determine whether or not children and grandchildren set their hope in God. I tell you, one of the things that I'm most excited about as the trustee of the Baptist College of Florida, and I just want to kind of give you a little preview here. We're doing some amazing things at the Baptist College of Florida. We have just linked up with Calvary Church in Clearwater to start another campus there. That church is allowing us to use, or practically giving it to us, a six-story building where we're going to be able to have a central campus there in Clearwater in the center of our state. And we're going to develop a top-notch Christian higher education school to give parents an alternative. Instead of sending their kids off to a secular university that's going to do everything they can to corrupt their minds. And friend, listen, I'm not against higher education. I'm all for it. I've got a little bit of it myself. But I'm telling you, higher education in our country, in our state, is in trouble. Matter of fact, about the only way you can get hired today to be a professor at a university is to be woke in your philosophy. And if we could provide for our state something for Christian parents, that would be top of the line education. But they could go into that school and get a biblical worldview rather than a secular worldview. What a difference in the future that we could make in our state. The Baptist College of Florida, which, by the way, next year will be known as Florida Baptist University. We've already achieved that status. And we are absolutely thrilled and excited over the possibility of Christian higher education in the state of Florida. Well, that's my little commercial. But as you can see, I am pumped and stoked about the potential and the possibility of that. But I think the major thing that we learn from this before I close is the danger of just snuggling up too close to the world. That's what Joshua was saying. Don't intermingle in your marriage with these pagans. You know, stay separated from the world. And that's not just an Old Testament doctrine, is it? What does Romans 12, verses 1 and 2 say? I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. John said, do not love the world or the things that are in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, it's not of the Father, but it's of the world. And the world's passing away and the lust of it all. But he who does the will of God abides forever. And so in closing, he says, here is what I want you as leaders to do and teach your people. Obey God, love God, lives lives that are separate from the world. Well, that's a good stopping place. We'll pick up there next week. Would you stand, please, and we will be dismissed. And Father, thank you once again for your incredible word. Thank you that, as the book of Hebrews says, it's living, it's powerful, it's sharper than any double-edged sword. And God, I pray that you would give us in these last days a greater passion than we've ever had to obey the teachings of the Word. Help us to learn it, to study it, God, to know it. Lord, help us to teach it to the generation that is coming up behind us. Lord, I thank you for the young people that we have in our church that I really see in their heart a desire, Lord, to follow you and serve you and live for you, and help us as a church to take our example from Psalm 78 and from the teachings of Joshua and do everything that we can to pour into these young lives, to equip them to grow up to be the men and the women of God that you have called them to be. Father, I pray tonight that as we leave this place, that we would be reminded as we are leaving, we're heading out into a mission field, that we might let our light so shine that people may see our good works and glorify our Father which is in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You are dismissed.